Rodney Jaffe, one of the early DNS pioneers. Rodney, thank you for taking the time to talk to us. How did you become initially involved with the domain name system?
Actually, quite interesting, as you might imagine. I actually started out providing some of the connectivity for the very early part of the commercial internet. So in the late 80s, early 90s, John Postel, who at that time was at USC, was looking for someone to provide a node for the Los Nerdos network, which is one of the original networks pre the real commercial internet. And I happened to be based in an area of Los Angeles where I was able to complete a circle for the network they were putting in. At that time it was a T3 network.
When you say you were based in a place, you mean geographically based?
Geographically. So when they looked at a map around Los Angeles, there were a group of members of Los Nerdos. There was USC, UCLA, Caltech, JPL, RAND Corporation, TRW. But there was no one in the San Fernando Valley. And I had met John. He knew that I was involved in starting a little ISP and just dabbling. And so probably 1992, 93, he asked if I would make room in a rack for a router that would be that would complete the circle around Los Angeles for Los Nerdos. And I did that and got obviously very friendly with John. The ISP that I'd started as part of my computer company, which at the time was called American Computer Group, that ISP had started up in this little building in Sherman Oaks, Los Angeles. Over time, it began to add more customers, so I became a formal part of the Los Nerdos network. And I then sold a piece of that to a company called Bechtel. With Bechtel, I developed some capabilities with load balancing. We'd formed a company, an ISP called Genuity, which was really the original hosting ISP, backbone hosting ISP, sort of created the category of co-location, bringing computers to where the network was rather than taking network to the computers. And we did that in about 1995. And I'd asked John if he would be my other board member. There were board members from Bechtel, and I had two seats. And I asked John if he would be my other board member. And oddly enough, it was the only time that John ever got involved with a commercial company. But he saw the value in it and was a good friend and mentor. And so John took the other position. We built that company, ultimately sold it to GTE. But during that process, I had actually developed some technology and a patent around load balancing, which made use to some extent of DNS. I'd looked, once I'd sold the company, I'd looked at some of the things that I'd wanted to do with load balancing and with content distribution, and there was some need around DNS. I talked to the folks that were really key with the DNS world at the time, people like Paul Vixie, who was a good friend, and I suggested doing two things would have made a difference from the commercial point of view. I think I was probably the first person who came out of the commercial world into the backbone of the internet rather than coming from the internet world. And Paul had said that things that I wanted to do were inappropriate and violated the RFCs and the spirit of the way things worked. And I sat and thought about it for 2 or 3 weeks and then decided to go ahead anyway and built a company called UltraDNS. With the technology. The key thing that I developed then was I really pioneered the use of Anycast for DNS, which was one of the two things that Paul had said was totally inappropriate and wrong.
You didn't care about the inappropriate part.
I have, through most of my life, if something seems right to me, you know, I move forward with it, and it had a lot of people very upset. I began to develop that company, and John Postel, had suggested that I hire part-time one of his key researchers at USC, Steve Hutz. And Steve Hutz is the person who actually wrote something called DIG, which is still today the most commonly used method of looking at DNS records. But Steve came to work with me. We developed Ultra DNS. I actually was enough of a pariah that I was almost ejected from an IETF meeting in San Diego in 1998 and 1999 for the heresy that I was proposing. I developed Anycast as a method of being able to really survive distributed denial of service attacks that hadn't really happened yet, but there were threats of it, but also provided a lot more reliability. And so a short time after we had this in production, somewhere around 2002, there was a major denial of service attack against the root servers. And it turns out that some of the root server operators had been testing what I'd been doing. I'd made it publicly available, had been watching it, had seen that, in fact, it made a lot of sense, even though the RFC said that it couldn't and shouldn't be done. They decided to implement it themselves. And in the DDoS attack, there were 13 root servers. A portion of them weren't affected by the DDoS. They remained up and serving. Mm-hmm. And it was the portion that used the Anycast technology. And so it was quite interesting because not very long after that, and this is almost becoming a discussion about Paul Vixie, who's certainly one of the fathers of DNS.
Certainly a legend, yeah.
Yes, together with Paul Mockapetras, who obviously invented it. Paul had actually done an interview and said that DNS violates all of the RFCs, it violates the rules, it breaks all kinds of things theoretically, but as it turns out, in the case of denial of service attack, it's the only way to remain up. And he, at that time, was operating the FRoot server, and he said, so we're going to be implementing Anycast on the FRoot server, which was almost a vindication for that idea. So that's how I got involved. As I said, John Postel, one of his folks had actually joined me in 98.
Talk to me a little bit about Postel. I mean, obviously I never met the man, but I've heard so much about him. On a personal level, what was it like to work with him?
It was very interesting. John was, you know, when you dealt with him, was one of the gentlest of souls. I mean, he literally was incredibly thoughtful. I'd never heard him raise his voice. You know, obviously, I'd never worked for him. We'd worked together on different things. I was in the private sector. But I remember at one of the Los Nerdos board meetings, he'd come up to me and very proudly, one of the first times ever, had taken out a little box, and he opened the box and he showed me something. I said, what is that? And he said, well, he just received a medal from the ITU, which was really odd because the ITU was almost almost a sworn enemy of the internet with their interest in really having some kind of input and control. Or trying to think about how to do that over the internet. Mm-hmm. But John was very proud of that. So it was interesting because he was humble, but he also, you know, occasionally things made him feel pretty good. It was the only thing I ever saw where he actually had this sort of, you know, smile about, you know, look at this neat thing, one of the few times. Besides that, he was very quiet, obviously very thoughtful and brilliant, mm-hmm. incredibly trusted. In fact, one of the things that used to happen is when he sat on my board, which was 96, we would fly up to San Francisco from Los Angeles once a month for a board meeting, and we'd have conversations. And during this period, John had actually been sued by someone who wanted to get a top-level domain called God, wanted the .god top-level domain. And John, of course, wasn't going to have any of that. It wasn't in his plan at all. But he was ultimately sued by the person who was. It was actually a small group of two or three people, and it put an enormous amount of pressure on him. And one of the things that I was able to do with my partners Bechtel was to provide him with some legal support to be able to actually deal with that. But at that time, I could already see that there were a couple of things he was thinking of. He was worrying about, number one, his health and mm-hmm. the pressure put on him. Number two, he was worried about the fact that in this particular case, things may happen to the internet from a government point of view. This was just at the time that The US government was starting to recognize that the internet was more than, you know, just an experiment for scientists.
It was pre Ira Magaziner's involvement.
Correct. Pre his involvement. And so John and I would talk on the trips up and down about what kind of thing would actually work, putting it in place that would protect it from what he saw as the coming threat to the government. He also said, you know, now that the internet was becoming more of a commercial thing, he had a concern. He said, you know, his first concern was, I'm one person and I'm running IANA and I'm assigning names and numbers, but I'm just one person. At the time, he was obviously under attack from a legal point of view.
Mm-hmm.
And so he started to, you know, think and discuss this idea of putting together some kind of organization that would be able to take it over from him should something happen. So he was clearly, I think he'd been ill in 1990 mm-hmm. and had some surgery, and so there was some concern with that. Over the next couple of years, so all the way through 1996, so 96, 97, when we sold the company to GTE, that sort of gelled and we'd have conversations. And I know I was a minor part of it. He was talking to many other people,
sure.
People like Vinton and Steve Crocker and Esther Dyson and many others. But he would, you know, try ideas on me because I seemed to be the one person who'd actually started companies, and mm-hmm. he said something had to be started. We then sold the company, but I was then involved with Los Neros. And so with the Los Neros process, we then moved into the area where, as you know, Ira Magaziner came into the picture. The whole issue of control of the internet, he ran his famed experiment where he pointed, he had some of the root servers point to him for an update instead of VeriSign. Which certainly was an eye-opener. Of course, that got
eye-opener for a lot of people.
But also got the government obviously very upset. But
yeah.
It really was. But the interesting thing is that it absolutely showed the trust that he had. So this is even before the time when he and Ira Magaziner would travel around the world trying to get countries to sign on to what ultimately became the organization ICANN. John was already, you know, the most trusted person out there.
Right.
Everyone trusted him. As the ICANN thing came along, he would come to the board meetings and talk about the fact that, you know, he was now doing a lot of traveling together with the government, who were looking to get signatories. I guess that, you know, sort of a way of maybe finishing that part up was, as you know, on a Tuesday in the beginning of October in 98, he took ill. I got a call from the folks that I worked with at Los Neros and USCISI, who said that he was very ill. They called for blood donors. I'd asked why it wasn't being talked about publicly, and they'd indicated that they'd been asked by Ira Magaziner or the US government interchangeably to keep quiet about it.
Wow.
Because it would upset the negotiations that were going on to get countries to sign the original ICANN agreement.
Mm-hmm.
So we were told to keep it very quiet. There were only a couple of hundred people, I think, who knew about it. I wasn't able to give blood. I'm born in South Africa, and at that time there was a ban on anyone from Sub-Sahara donating blood. And then on a Friday afternoon, about 1:30, I got a call from USC to say that John had just passed away. Danny Cohen, who you know, hopefully you'll be talking to. Or torture ready. Danny was in the room with John at the time. John passed away, and it's very interesting. If you go back and look at the Internet archives, it looks like the reason that Ira Magaziner and the government were so concerned about announcing the fact that he was ill, and obviously gravely ill, was that they were concerned that some of the governments that were part way to signing the agreement, which was, you know, just done based on trust of John, might get cold feet and maybe back out. And so from what I understand, and I don't know this firsthand, but I was told that there was a flurry of people who were actually traveling around the world trying to get the agreement signed with different governments in a hurry.
Yeah.
I got the call at about 1:30, I think, that John had passed away. If you look going back and look at it, about 2 or 2:30, there was the official announcement of the creation of this thing called ICANN, the U.S. government announced that there was now this formal organization that had, I think, 40 or 50 signatories. And then half an hour later, they announced the fact that John had passed away. So it looked like that was, you know, for 2 weeks over there, it was a driver to get as many countries as possible to sign.
Interesting.
And the lid was put on the fact that he was ill in order to not jeopardize people from the government being able to go out and sign and get signed the agreements that ICANN has founded on, as many of them as possible before something occurred with John, which sadly occurred on, you know, in fact, you know, October 16th of 98.
So in those early days, in ICANN's initial days, they were borrowing space from USC in Marina del Rey.
Correct. And it was mostly people just doing good things. It was engineers, predominantly technical people. Obviously, John, you know, there were people who'd worked with John who were involved with it. It grew legs over time, and not only legs, but it grew very big legs, and it grew many bodies, and it started to become much more of an organization. I was involved relatively early on, just talking to John on the side. Once ICANN came into being and John was no longer involved when he passed away, I wasn't that involved in the development of it from a policy point of view. It's just not my thing.
Right.
You know, I consider myself to be predominantly a geek. However, I ended up being involved with the ICANN Security and Stability Advisory Committee, the ESSAC. Steve had asked me to join. I was involved with the nominating committee for a number of years. And over time, it became very clear that the GAC part of it, the government part of it, was starting to impose itself more and more into the everyday business of the internet. Some of it may have been good. A lot of it, I think, was became very political. There were a number of things that went on, you know, in back rooms that I was part of around certain communities in the world, certain countries mm-hmm. that felt they were underrepresented, quite rightly. Things like the internationalized domain names was an issue. And then it started to become just yet another one of those really big organizations. When the expansion of the GTLDs came about, it was very clear that this was now becoming a large enterprise. There were things that I saw that I just didn't agree with in terms of how funds were spent, funds were raised and how they were spent. Committees just seemed to expand. And it got to the point where it wasn't enjoyable and fun anymore, and I didn't feel that I could make a difference.
What I'm hearing, and correct me if I'm wrong, what I'm hearing is it sounds almost like you're buying into the concept of ICANN, the way that it was formed and the way it's supposed to function, but you were concerned the committees were becoming so large, there were so many disparate voices, that it wasn't coming together smoothly. That's a rough interpretation.
So
that's
a good part of it. The second part of it is that there were special interests that were getting more and more influence and control.
Meaning their voices were getting louder?
Their voices were getting louder, and obviously they had more and more influence in terms of the committees and the ICANN organization itself. So that you would have this rotating group of people who didn't know much about the internet but knew about policy, people that knew a lot about the policy of the internet in the commercial world, but didn't have technical knowledge. There were very few people on the ICANN board that had technical knowledge, which was one of the things that during my time on the nominating committee, we did everything we could to change. But it just got to the point where the bloat seemed unreasonable, where the special interests looked like everything else that I'd come to see in Washington, but on a larger scale because this was multinational.
In addition to that, I'm guessing this sort of marriage between policy formation, representatives of GAC, for example, and the technical types, of which you were one, and sort of the coordination and the marriage of them toward the formation of policy sounds difficult at best.
It really was. I mean, the interesting thing is that the internet worked and still today works really well because the technical folks are actually making it happen, not the policy folks. There are a number of initiatives that go on behind the scenes where it's just us geeks keeping the wheels on the bus. And as we've sort of migrated into the modern world where security is a real issue, ICANN has no value and provides no value add whatsoever from a security point of view. No matter what anyone says, there's no value there. But that's probably the single most important thing that's facing us. Mm-hmm. It's the technical folks. And so what's really happened is that the technical part of the internet, the geeks and the scientists and so on, and the technicians and the operators are the people that have actually kept the wheels on the bus. And ICANN has very little influence on that and really doesn't matter a whole lot. It's just not relevant.
Well, at the end of the day, ICANN is supposed to be, oversimplified, of course, but supposed to be a technical coordination body. Are you saying it's kind of straight from that, or it's not involved in the, you mentioned security, critical issue from this point forward? Are you saying that it's strayed from that, or are you saying that that is a part of a mission that is may not be the central or primary focus that it should be in the future?
I believe that the technical aspect of the internet is no longer, and the operation of the internet is no longer core to ICANN. There are some brilliant, wonderful technical folks in ICANN. Over time, some really good people have been brought on. There was a period when there was a shortage of them within ICANN. ICANN, I guess, has enough of a budget now to be able to say, we have to fill seats. We may as well go and fill them with technical people. And they happen to have chosen some very, very good technical people. But in reality, this has become a policy-based process and a business-based process, and the technical part of it is just by the wayside. Well, you can look at that, by the way, when you look at ESSEC. ESSEC, within the charter, I don't think it's changed, was developed and is chartered to provide advice to the CEO of ICANN. Instead of saying it really needs to provide policy and some form of oversight that actually affects the technical operation of the internet. So you have the ESSEC looking at problems, coming up with papers and presentations and recommendations. Most times, those things get knocked down because there's a business constituency that those policies don't suit. And I've seen that happen for years.
It sounds almost like you're saying ICANN has lost its roots.
Oh, there's no question it's lost its roots. There's no question of that. So it's not almost I'm saying it. I am saying that. But there are still some good people, but they have an uphill battle. And I don't know where ICANN's going to go.
What's the biggest risk to ICANN moving forward?
I believe the biggest risk to ICANN is that it will become yet another international organization that's controlled by policies within governments around the world and has very little interest in the constituencies that actually rely on the internet.
Rodney Jaffe, thank you very much for taking the time to
talk to us. Thanks for having me.